Good morning, City Church. Please stand to your feet and praise the Lord with us. Amen. Come on.
Is coming, still you're calling me. When faith is lost and my hope exhausted, you will be my strength. So when my mind says I'm not good enough, God, you're enough for me. I've decided.
Together again this Sunday. I don't know about you, but this is Sundays are like my favorite days of the week because we get to get together and do this right here. Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Well, before we continue, let's just take a moment and greet someone beside you, in front of you, behind you. Say hello. Hi. How are you? And we will continue in this worship.
Maybe it's okay if I'm not okay, because the one who holds the world is holding on to me. Maybe it's all right if I'm not all right, because the one who holds the stars is holding our lives. This song is an amazing promise of God's faithfulness to us. Let's sing together. Grace is sufficient for all of us this morning. It's okay that we're not okay, Lord, because you are our provider, our healer, our great redeemer. So continue to be with us, Father, throughout this service, throughout the rest of this week, Lord, as we give our lives to you. And in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
Yes, thank you. You may be seated. Hey, City Church, it's so good to see you guys today. You guys know that we exist so all people can believe and thrive in Jesus. And last week, we got to celebrate with some people who identified themselves as believers in Jesus. In fact, 67 people got baptized last week. Yeah, that was awesome. That makes 112 people so far this year who have become believers in Jesus and got baptized. And so we celebrate with all of you. And if you're one of those, we're so happy for you. Welcome to the family. You're a child of God. That's who you are. once you've identified yourself as a believer in Jesus, and we're excited for you. And so whenever you give to the City Church movement, you enable us to provide the services and programs that are changing people's lives, like those who got baptized. And so I do ask you to give generously because it makes a difference. Now, City Church is a people, not a place. We are a body. We're the body of Christ. We are not a building. We are a movement, not a meeting. And as a movement, you can join us. And I do invite you to join this movement. And so today, this afternoon at 2:30, I'm going to be hosting a Join the Movement gathering in the video cafe. If you have children, we will provide childcare for your kids so that you can join us. It'll take a little bit less than an hour. And in the gathering, I'm going to share with you a little bit about who we are as a movement, a little bit of our vision as a church, give you the opportunity to ask any questions you might have about City Church, and then I will talk to you about what it means to join this kind of church movement. And so I do ask you to join this movement to help us make a difference here in San Antonio. And so I invite you to join us. I hope to see you there at 2:30. You don't have to register anything. You can just show up. Now, Pastor Sherri is back with us to continue our series, Broken and Blessed, and I know you're going to be blessed. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Well, hey, y'all. I'm so excited to be here with you today as we continue our Broken and Blessed series, where we're looking at what it is that God has to say, both about being broken, but also about the blessings that we can experience even in the midst of our brokenness. I have to move these boxes or I will trip on them and you will laugh at me and I will be embarrassed for the rest of my life. All right. And so, in this topic has been something that has been really important to me over the last, I would say, months and maybe even couple of years, because I have seemed to keep finding myself in seasons of brokenness. And so I've really wrestled with this balance and this tug of war about what it looks like to be blessed, maybe even in the midst of my own brokenness. And I know, getting to spend a lot of time with many of you, that this has been a season of significant brokenness for a lot of people. I'm just seeing it even more recently than I have in my past years of ministry. So I knew this was something that we needed to talk about, something that is really difficult to talk about, but really matters. And so last week, as we kicked off our series, we looked at the story of Joseph. Now, in Joseph's story, we see so many difficult things happen to him. We see brokenness happen that primarily comes from the decisions of other people. That's where a lot of the brokenness in our lives come from, is the free will of others, other people's choices that lead us to brokenness. But what we discovered in Joseph's story was that even in the midst of the most difficult moments in his life, that God was there with him. And in that, he could experience true blessing. And so if you happen to miss last week, I encourage you to go jump online on any of our online platforms to go and check that out, because I know it will be a blessing to you, especially if you've been finding yourself in a season of brokenness. And today, I want us to look at a different kind of brokenness in our lives, the kind of brokenness that seems to kind of come from the world around us. There's not really anyone to blame. It's just the accumulation of the things that happen in our lives. And so one of my favorite books when I was young was Alexander and the Terrible, Horrible, No Good, Very Bad Day. We find a story of a young man, Alexander, who wakes up with gum in his hair. Right, his brothers get toys in their cereal boxes. Are there still toys that come in cereal boxes? Is that still a thing? Well, that's a terrible, horrible thing. All right, so his brothers get toys in their cereal boxes. He doesn't. He doesn't get to sit by the window in the carpool on the way to school. No dessert with his lunch. Goes to the dentist. Has a cavity. And worst of all, there are lima beans with dinner. Like, this is a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. And we have all experienced days like this, just kind of grown-up versions, where a bunch of little things just seem to chip away at us, leading to us just having that terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. It's not really anybody's fault. It's just the accumulation of life that happens around us. Sometimes it's a day, sometimes it's a week or a season. Or maybe you find yourself today in a place where it seems like life is just a series of terrible, horrible, no good, very bad days. And it's leaving you feeling broken. This kind of brokenness can be especially difficult to us because there isn't any really anyone to blame. And blame, we'll talk about this in a minute, but blame actually makes us feel a lot better. It gives us control in a specific situation. But when life is just kind of crashing in around us, it can feel like there's no one to blame. All right, things like layoffs at work, things like a burst pipe in your house, a flat tire, really like kind of derailing things in our lives sometimes. However, there's not anyone to blame. They're things that just happen. And sometimes they are really big things that can happen in our life. So life has some difficulties up its sleeve. Brokenness that is far beyond our control in our lives and outside of our threshold of resiliency. All right, think about the disease that can hold on to someone you love. And you sit, and as you sit with them and as you love them well in that season, you watch them deteriorate in front of you. And all of the possibilities of their future start to look like those things aren't ever going to happen. They're just this lost purpose and this lost potential outside of them, dreams that will never become realities. We see this in depression that seems to not let go of us. Those of us who have experienced depression, you know, maybe you get really good at covering it up, but it doesn't mean that it's not continuing to come in waves and to cause brokenness in our lives. The loss of someone that you love that seemed to just happen in a flash that leaves you looking around, not being able to make heads or tails of the world around you, you find yourself utterly broken. Right, the hopelessness of dealing with a lack of direction and a lack of purpose, not knowing what your next step is, finding yourself in phases of just unmet potential that can start to stack and weigh you down and lead you to a broken place. Right, someone that you love continuing down a destructive path that you hope isn't going to lead to the kind of brokenness that you can't come back from. That loneliness that you are experiencing, where you feel like you're isolated and alone and you have nowhere to turn in your life. Financial insecurities, the list could go on and on. Maybe even outside of your own life, you watch the pain and destruction that seems to be happening in the world around us constantly. Just the absolute, utter brokenness that can seem like is happening in the world around us. Hate, violence, poverty, injustice. It seems like it's never ending. And trying to make sense of brokenness like this, it can feel like trying to pick up and hold sand in our hands, and it's just streaming from between our fingers. It is so difficult to make sense of brokenness like this that's happening in the world around us. And when we experience brokenness like this, and there's no specific person to blame, it's really easy for us to turn on God. Like, God, if you are all powerful, where are you? God, if you have all the answers, why aren't you providing them? God, if you can fix anything, why aren't you fixing this? God, if you are everywhere, then where are you right now in my life in the middle of my brokenness? It is so easy to turn and to blame God when life doesn't look the way that we think that it should. Or even if you don't feel like you've turned on God, maybe like you've turned and you're blaming God, maybe you've just turned away from God. Because you feel alone and you feel like God has nothing to offer you because you continue to find yourself in these seasons of brokenness. In these questions, these, God, where are you? Why do bad things happen? All of those questions seem to mound up, and they are such important questions for us to wrestle with in our lives. Incredibly difficult questions that honestly, I don't think we're ever going to have perfect answers for on this side of heaven. But what I do know is it is important for us to ask those questions, especially when we're struggling. And so what are the answers to these difficult questions? So today, to try to get a grasp on this. I want us to look at a story that we find in the Jewish scriptures about a man named Job. And I'll tell you this, Job's story is one that in my career as a pastor and when I did youth ministry, writing curriculums, all those things, this is a story that I've actually never taught on because it is very much a bummer. Like if you're having a great day and you just are like want to balance it out, like go read Job. It'll bum you out plenty. And so the story of Job is one that is incredibly difficult. And so if we're going to talk about brokenness, Job, we have to talk about him too. And so let's jump in right here to introduce ourselves to Job. This is Job 1, 1 through 3. There was once a man named Job who lived in the land of Oz. He was blameless, a man of complete integrity. And so Job is a model citizen. He's one of the good guys. He's somebody that's actually accumulated a great deal of wealth and resources, somebody who honors God and everything that he has. He's an upstanding citizen. And so something that Job's story has that is unique, you do not find this anywhere else in Scripture, is that we don't just get the story of Job on the surface, like the events that are happening in his life. We also get this background conversation, right? DVD bonus features. We get this background conversation that's happening between God and Satan. And so some background before we can even jump further into the story is we have to understand a little bit about who Satan is. And so Satan was one of God's angels. He was actually an angel that was given a position of leadership and honor. And in his ambition, he decided that he desired to be like God. He desired to be worshiped like God. And so he leads a rebellion against God. Now this needs to be perfectly clear in all of our minds. God and Satan are not equals, not even close. So often they are depicted as equals, but this is not the case. And so as Satan leads a rebellion in heaven along with other angels who chose to follow him, they are sent out of heaven, cast out of heaven altogether. And so they're thrown down to the earth and Satan's attention switches to God's most prized creation. His attention switches towards humanity. And this is what we see in the story of humanity, if I can just boil it way down to its simplest kind of form, is what we see is Satan trying to make us like him. We see Satan trying to get us to rebel, to choose anything other than God. All right, rewind with me all the way back to the beginning with Adam and Eve. All right, when Satan came and he enticed Eve to eat the fruit, what he said was, if you eat this, you will be like God. Is that not what Satan desired? He was trying to skew humanity to make them like him, to make us like him, so that he can stand and offer it as a case study in front of God and go, see, they will choose to be like me. They will not choose to be like you. Watch as I break them. And so this conversation is happening in the background of Job's story. And so we're going to jump into Job 1:7. Where have you come from? The Lord asked Satan. Satan answered, Lord, I have been patrolling the earth, watching everything that is going on. All right, two really important things we need to see here is that it says patrolling and watching. All right, patrolling. All right, Satan is not omnipresent in the way that God is. He is not everywhere all the time. He is limited in what he can do. Once again, God and Satan are not equal. The second, watching. He has no access to your mind and to your heart and to who you are on the inside. He can only make observations. He can only watch what is happening. He and God are not equals. He cannot see in your heart and in your mind the way that God can. And so knowing Satan's schemes all too well, God shows Satan how he is failing in his endeavors. This is in Job 1:8. Then the Lord asked Satan, have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God, which means honors God. He fears God and stays away from evil. Basically, he's saying, look, your tactics are failing. There are those who will choose me and not your way. He's like a proud, like, grandparent on an airplane. Have you ever sat next to this guy that, like, pulls out pictures on their phone? Like, here, this is my nephew, this is my grandson, he's Job. Like, that's what's happening right here with God. He's going, look, your tactics, they're not working. And so this is Job 1:9. Satan replied to the Lord, yes, but Job has good reason to fear God. You have always put a wall of protection around him and his home and his property. You have made him prosper in everything he does. Look how rich he is. This is like the story of Joseph that we looked at last week. God was with Joseph and he helped him to succeed in everything that he did. And we see something similar here in the story of Job. And so what Satan is accusing, Satan means accuser, what he is accusing God of is buying Job's devotion. Right? Because let's be real, it's a lot easier to follow God, to turn towards God, to be about worshiping when things are going really great in our lives. When they're not, it's a whole different story. And that's what Satan is accusing God of. He's like, look, you're making Job's life great. Of course, he follows you. Satan continues, but reach out and take away everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. All right. You may test him, the Lord said to Satan. Do whatever you want with everything he possesses, but don't harm him physically. So Satan left the Lord's presence. This is such an incredibly difficult passage of scripture to wrestle with. There are for sure questions that I have that I don't have perfect answers to, but what we absolutely cannot miss here is that God does not will Job's pain. God is not the origin of Job's pain here. The origin of Job's brokenness falls squarely on the shoulders of Satan. This isn't hyperbole. It says it right here in the scripture. The origin of what is about to happen to Job falls squarely on Satan. And this is such a common thought. If God is all powerful and I am experiencing brokenness, then it must be his fault. But what we can see here is that God in no way wills Job's pain, but the enemy certainly does and will. And so Job is in his home when a messenger arrives and tells him that while his farmhands were using his oxen and his donkey to go and to plow his fields, that bandits, they came and they killed all of his farmhands and they stole all of his animals and his equipment that he used to make a livelihood. Before this messenger had even had the opportunity to finish, another messenger comes and says that a wildfire came and has killed all of his shepherds and his sheep that were out grazing in his fields. Before that messenger can even finish, another one comes and tells him that raiders have come and stolen his camels and killed his servants. And finally, the last messenger comes and says that all of his adult children, they were gathered together feasting when a great wind came and destroyed the building that they were in and that they were all killed. Job's terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day was so far beyond tragic, beyond comprehension. And Job's initial response to what has just happened is unusual to say the least. Let's jump in right here. This is Job 1:20. He says, I came naked from my mother's womb, and I will be naked when I leave. The Lord gave me what I had, and the Lord has taken it away. Praise the name of the Lord. In the midst of incredible tragedy, Job worships, which just seems unfathomable. And I have had the distinct honor of being in the room when someone has responded like this to incredible pain. I've seen it multiple times, probably a handful of times, and it is still shocking every single time it happens when someone's response to brokenness is worship. I saw this in my own family's life when my grandmother died, and the first words that my grandfather cried out were, "Thank you, God, for my beautiful wife." That's incredible. I have no idea how someone in such significant pain, this is their first choice, this is their first instinct, is to worship and thank God in the midst of incredible heartache. This is Job 1:22. In all of this, Job did not sin by blaming God. Now, the stages of grief, if you're familiar with them or not, the stages of grief are very universal. Almost everyone experiences these phases of grief. And we are very inconsistent in our grief. We are all over the place when we experience that denial, anger, bargaining, depression, acceptance. No one goes through grief as this stoic bubble of consistency. Even if someone is really good at masking it, which is not healthy, by the way, but even if we are really good at covering it up, we are certainly not consistent in our emotions and in our experiences day to day after a tragedy like this has happened. We see Job in the midst of just this short amount of time. We see him cry out to God. We see him worship. We see him cover himself in ashes, which is like the equivalent of you or I wearing black after someone we love has died. And finally, at one point, we just see him sit in the dirt in silence for 7 whole days. Which is so relatable to me because this is where I go when I feel broken into this very numb and still place where I feel like I can just stare at the wall endlessly because it feels like there's just nothing to grab hold of. It feels like everything is just chaos around me. And that is where Job sits for 7 whole days. This is Job 3:1. At last, Job spoke and he cursed the day of his birth. Why wasn't I born dead? Why didn't I die as I came from my mother's womb? And so his friends and his wife, they come alongside him in his pain, and they don't do a great job. His wife comes first, and she says, "Why don't you just curse God and go ahead and die?" Like, y'all, I don't think I'm a great wife, but this makes me feel a lot better about myself. Job's friends, they come and they sit with him for those 7 days, which is incredible. Go and sit with the people that you love when they are experiencing brokenness in their life. But once they start talking, they kind of put their foot in their mouth. And so Job's friend, as they sit with them, they give all kinds of ridiculous reasons why this might be happening. Well, Job, maybe you didn't have enough faith. Well, maybe you had too much faith. Maybe you shouldn't have faith at all. Maybe this was your kid's fault. Maybe this was your fault. And that's where they land more than anywhere else. Job, maybe this is your fault, which is so often where we default when we see brokenness in someone's life or even our own lives. We say, look, look what happened. Look what you did. Look, you got what you deserve. You made the bed, now lay in it. We cause faults on others when we see brokenness in their lives. Right? Do you know how your mama told you if you didn't have anything nice to say, you shouldn't say anything at all? All right, their mamas must have forgotten to say that because they spend so much time faulting Job. And he sits and he tolerates this for a great deal of time, but he hits the point in his grief where he has had enough. And we all get there in one way or another in our grief, where we have had enough. And his responses, they become less calculated, less put together, and eventually he begins to blame God. This is Job 24:22, and this is read, this whole book is written in a poetry style, so you'll see that really come out in the next few verses we look at. It says, God in his power drags away the rich. They may rise high, but they have no assurance of life. They may be allowed to live in security, but God is always watching them. And though they are great now, in a moment they will be gone like all the others, cut off like heads of grain. Can anyone claim otherwise? Who can prove me wrong? God can do whatever he wants, basically, is what Job's saying. God can do anything that he wants, but look what he is doing to me. Look at the pain that he is causing me. Who can prove me wrong? Blame is such an effective tool when we are experiencing brokenness in our lives. Blame creates an instant kind of relief for us. It doesn't last for long, but it brings some kind of satisfaction to us when we can turn towards something or someone and we can blame them for the pain that we are experiencing. Blame helps to, if it's something that's our fault, it helps us put fault or put guilt onto someone else. It helps us dodge accountability if we're the one in the wrong. Blame gives us somewhere to orient our anger. It makes us feel like we have some kind of a semblance of control. Blame is an incredibly effective and relief-based tool when we are in a broken place like Job is right now. It pours out of us, and it is an incredibly human response. It is something that we have all done at one level or another, in one situation or another. We have opted to blame someone else, or maybe even God. After a long while, God responds to Job. Who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words? Brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. Like, is this really how God is going to respond to Job in his pain? Like, be a man and listen? Like, man up and stop your whining? Like, is this really how God is going to respond to Job in the middle of his pain? And so God, he starts asking Job questions, just like he said he was going to. I have questions for you, and you are going to answer them. He proceeds to ask a series of questions. I'm going to read some examples. He says, where were you when I laid down the foundations of the earth? Have you ever commanded the morning to appear and caused the dawn to rise in the east? Have you made daylight spread to the ends of the earth to bring an end to the night's wickedness? Where does light come from and where does it go? Can you take each to its home? Do you know how to get there? Can you shout to the clouds and make them rain? Can you make lightning and cause it to strike as you direct? Who gives intuition to the heart and instinct to the mind? Who is wise enough to count all of the clouds? Who can tilt the water jars of heaven when the parched ground is dry and the soil has hardened? This goes on for pages and pages. And finally, God says, what's your answer? Like, if you know all this, then what is your answer to all of these questions that I've asked you? And this is how Job responds. He says, I am nothing. How could I ever find the answers? I will cover my mouth with my hand. I have said too much already, and I have nothing more to say. Job is saying, I don't have answers to your questions, God. In fact, I don't have any answers at all. And this is where we find ourselves so easily in seasons of brokenness, when the world crashes down around us, when everything looks dark and gray, when everything looks helpless and when it looks hopeless. This is where we find ourselves, in this place where we just don't understand what is going on, where we can't put two and two together. We can't figure it out. This is where we sit with no answers, no control, helpless and hopeless, angry and bitter, betrayed and broken. This is where we find ourselves in moments like this. And is this really how God responds to us? Like, God, how about instead of playing Jeopardy? How about instead of answering and like asking me 500 questions, how about you do something, like how about you do something to help me? All right, God, why don't you go ahead and fix this? Like, why don't you go back and fix this? If you are all powerful, tell me why on earth all of this is happening. Why don't you comfort me instead of challenging me and asking me all of these questions? Why don't you unbreak me, God? Why don't you fix all of my problems, God? Or if nothing else, why can't you help me understand? God, can you just help me understand what is happening here? This is where we find ourselves in seasons of brokenness. God, why? Why is this happening? Can you just help me understand? stand. But what if God was trying to help Job understand? What if God's response to Job's pain was to let him know him more? What if God's response to Job's pain was to show him who he is so that Job could be drawn more into him? What if the response wasn't God telling Job off, but rather letting him see him in new and different ways, even in the midst of his incredible brokenness? I think that's what's happening here. And the reason I think that we can know this for certain is based on the way that Job responds right here. This is what he says in Job 42:5. He says, I had only heard about you before. I had only heard about you, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. God, I knew about you, but now I know you. Job continues, I take back everything I said. I sit in the dust and ashes to show my repentance. I sit in ashes, God, to show you that I have turned away from my way, God, and I am turning towards your way. I am turning away from my blame, and I am turning towards a better understanding of who you are. I am turning from my grief, God, to the comfort that you are providing me as you draw me in closer. When God shows him more of who he is, Job begins to recognize that God is certainly not the origin of his brokenness. But very soon, Job is going to come to know that God is the origin of his blessings. In seasons of difficulty, and when we see God as all-knowing and all-powerful, it is so easy to turn our attention on God and to blame him for what is happening in our lives, but this cannot be said enough. God does not will the brokenness that we experience in our lives. That is not what he is doing. We live in a very broken world that does not need any help breaking us. We live in a very broken world where we have free will that causes us brokenness. The people in our lives have will that can cause us brokenness. We have an enemy patrolling the world, causing a chaos and brokenness in our world. The world does not need any help breaking us. It is not God who wills our brokenness, but he will come alongside us, and he will let us know more about who he is, even in the middle of our brokenness. Our broken world does not need any help whatsoever. And let me tell you, I may not be able to give you all of the answers to the world's toughest questions. I promise. If I could, I would. I can't give you perfect answers to why do bad things happen to good people. I can't give you those really difficult answers to those questions. Like, we can wrestle with those all you want, but we'll likely never be satisfied with the answers. But when I can tell you for certain is that in seasons of brokenness, even when we turn on God, even when we go our own way, even when we say, God, I don't want your help, or we say, God, I don't even believe in you, because why would you let these things happen? That even in those moments, that God's desire is not to will more pain in your lives. God's desire is not to push you away because of your doubt. God's desire is to let you know more about who he is, and to draw you in so that you can come to know him better, even in the midst of your brokenness. I'm sorry, the answer isn't that God's gonna show up and make everything happy, but the fact is he won't leave you alone in the midst of your brokenness. And so right now, the band's gonna come out, and I want us to take a moment just to let God draw us in. To let God show us a little bit about himself. Based on whatever unique season that we're in, that God would reveal to us something new about him so that we can come to know him better, and in that we can be blessed. And so whatever season you're in, whether it's a season of amazing blessing, thank God, whether it's a season of complete brokenness or anything in between, or even if you don't even know where you are right now, that's fine. But in this moment, let's set aside all of those questions. Let's set aside some of that brokenness and some of that blame. And let's take just a few minutes to let God draw us in and to allow him to show us who he is. And so, God, we thank you that in our brokenness, your desire is not to push us away, God, but it is to draw us in. It is to let us know you more, God. And so in this moment, I pray that you would just wash over us, God, and that you would just reveal to each of us something new about you. God, in this moment of rest and in this moment of worship, that you would bring us a peace and a comfort, God, that only you can provide as you draw us in difficult and broken seasons, God. We love you, and it is your name that we pray. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Yes, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord,
And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm calling.
I just want you.
just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave.
So you guys can have a seat just for a second. So as Job's story comes to an end, I want to show you what happens. So this is Job 42. It says, the Lord restored his fortunes. In fact, the Lord gave him twice as much as before. And let me tell you that I think we can be quite confident that this was beyond the blessings that Job could even imagine for his life. And guys, we can't get this, church. We cannot fall into the trap to believe that blessings are only blessings when they have a dollar sign next to them. Like, this is what happened in Job's life, all right? But blessings can go so far beyond this. The blessings in your life may very well look like Job's. That's awesome. It may look like reconciliation of relationships in your life. It may look like a new purpose in front of you that drives you and just gives you a reason to get up in the morning. I don't know what the blessings are going to look like in your life, but I know that one of them certainly will be that if in our brokenness we will allow God to draw us nearer to him, that we will never have any kind of shortage of blessings as we come to know him more and more, as we come to understand who he is, and when we come to understand his great love for us. And so do not be fooled, guys. In our brokenness, God does not desire to push us away, but rather to draw us in and to let us know more of who he is, and in that we will always be incredibly blessed. And so, God, I just thank you for who you are. I thank you that you are not a God who pushes us away or who throws us out when we have doubts, God, and when we struggle and when we turn and we yell, God, why? When we go, God, where are you, God? But that rather you are a God who will draw us in and say, I am right here. I never went anywhere. I am right here. And that, God, you would draw us in and just continue to show us more of who you are, God. And so right now I pray that you would open our hearts, that you would open our minds, and that even in the middle of stubbornness and of brokenness and of pain and of bitterness, God, that you would open our hearts to allow us to begin to see you working and moving in our lives, God, that you would allow us to know you more, God, whatever that looks like for each of us, and in that we would start to and begin to see that we truly are blessed, God, because we have a God who is with us and who does not leave us alone, God. We love you, and it is in your name that we pray. Amen. Amen. So if today you are here and you are wrestling with something and you want to pray with someone, our prayer counselors are going to be right down front. Please don't leave today. If you are in need of prayer, if you're online, you can just drop into the comments, I need prayer. And man, somebody in our community is going to hop on there and pray with you. You don't have to be a prayer team member, folks. If you are online and you want to pray with somebody, go for it. I know that they will be blessed by you and your prayers today. And so if you need prayer, don't leave today without it. If you're interested in joining the City Church movement, remember our Join the Movement event is coming up here after at 2:30 after our 1 o'clock service. And next week, y'all, let me tell you, we're going to jump into what it is that Jesus has to say about brokenness and how he redeems our brokenness. Let me tell you, you are not going to want to miss that. It is going to be significant for each of you guys. We love you. We'll see you next week.